Yeah, so in the previous video we discussed what learning rate decay is and why it might be useful. Let's now see how we can do this in practice in PyTorch. So first, the manual way, the tedious way, we can define our own function to do learning rate decay in PyTorch. So here I defined a function called adjustLearningRate, and this is implementing the exponential decay that we talked about in the last video. So what it is doing is it's every 10th epoch, so this line may read a little bit counterintuitively, because this modulus operator is essentially doing a division and then returning the remainder of that division. So if I have a number that is not divisible by 10, it will return the remainder. And here it's essentially saying if there's no remainder, then do this. So it's essentially doing something every 10 epochs. So if the number is divisible by 10, do this. And what I'm doing here is I'm essentially implementing the exponential decay, and I'm applying it to the learning rate. So I implemented this in a way here that looks a little bit complicated. That is because there are different optimizers, and some optimizers have different learning rates for different parameter groups and so forth. So this will essentially take care of updating all the learning rates that are relevant. All right, so this would be the tedious way, and then you can call this function after every epoch. So if you have a for loop, so for epoch in range num epochs or something like that, and then for each, I'm not writing it out, but for each mini batch essentially, then you do your training, and you would have this function for each epoch, but not for each minibatch. So you would put it essentially here, like adjust learning rate and so forth. I can't write down here because I have my color bar here, but you would put essentially the function here, adjust learning rate, with the optimizer as input, the epoch number, the initial learning rate, and the decay rate, and then it will update every 10th epoch. However, this is just the manual way, so you can see how you could implement it yourself if you have an idea for a new learning rate. But in practice, if you want to just use an existing common way of doing learning rate decay, you can use one of the built-in functions in PyTorch. So for that, I recommend going to this website. They have a selection of different learning rate schedulers. Here's just an example that is a very generic one. So here I chose a screenshot of this particular example because it came with a practical example, so I didn't have to retype it. So how this works is essentially that you initialize the scheduler. So here it's this lambda learning rate scheduler. You give it the optimizer and then these values. And then you iterate over the epochs. And then for each epoch you call this dot step essentially, and then you have your train function and validation function that we usually use in this class too. So essentially there are two steps only. One step is initializing it, and the second step is essentially using it, and that's it. And you can do that with any type of scheduler they have on that website. So here I'm showing you now how that works with the exponential learning rate scheduler. So here I have first initialization of a model, then I initialize my optimizer here. I'm using a stochastic gradient descent optimizer, and then I'm initializing my scheduler. So here, notice I'm giving it the optimizer as input. And then I have my main training loop, so 5 epochs, set my model into training mode, and then I iterate over the mini batches. And this is our typical model training. So we call the model, compute the loss, set the gradients to 0, do back propagation, do the gradient. So here this is the applying the gradients. So backward will compute the gradients. Here we are doing the gradient update. Here's some logging. And then notice after the epoch, that's where we call the scheduler step. But you can also actually put it up here if you want to. So it doesn't really matter. All right, let's now talk about my favorite way of learning rate decay. So I'm not using learning rate decay that often because I usually find that Adam, an optimizer that we will be discussing later, works pretty well out of the box. But yeah, sometimes I compare it to SGD and learning rate decay, and I find it actually, yeah, this method works actually best compared to other methods I've tried. And yeah, I got this from a paper in 2016 on deep residual learning, which is the paper that originally proposed the ResNet, which we will be talking about also next week. It's among the most popular convolutional neural networks here. But yeah, here, I'm not sure if they proposed this learning rate decay method for the first time, but yeah, that's at least where I got the inspiration for that. So what they do is they use regular SGD with a mini batch size of 256, and then they start with a learning rate of 0.1, which is actually quite large for SGD. But yeah, they start with 0.1 and then divide it by 10 every time then when the error plateaus. So essentially, if they do the training and notice that the loss doesn't further go down, I mean, of course, there's some wiggle room. So if it stays, let's say, within a certain margin, then they divide the learning rate by 10. So yeah, that's the whole trick. And they also actually use weight decay of 0.0001. So weight decay, we discussed this in a previous lecture, that's essentially L2 regularization. And they use a momentum of 0.9. And momentum I will explain in the next video. But let me show you how this works in practice in PyTorch. So I prepared a code example. So I put it here as scheduler as an IPython or Jupyter notebook, and I will share that on the repository like always. So I will include a link under the video. And so what I'm doing here is I'm initializing the multi-layer perceptron from last week, where we used batch norm and dropout, and I'm now using a SGD with a learning rate of 0.1. And here, this is the learning rate scheduler from PyTorch that can be used similar to what they proposed in the previous slide, where they have basically the monitoring of the plateauing error and they divide by 10 every time the error plateaus. So this is essentially this learning rate scheduler here. So I'm providing it with the optimizer, and the factor is essentially by how much we divide it. So 0.1 means times 0.1, and times 0.1 is essentially dividing by 10, like they describe in the paper. But yeah, you can of course change that. It's another hyperparameter. Then there's a mode. So the mode, it really depends on where or what you apply this to. So you can apply this to anything you like during training. So here they say error. It's not quite clear what they mean by error. It could be either the loss or the classification error. Personally, I tried different things, and I find it usually works best if I do this on the error on the validation set or accuracy on the validation set. So I usually like to work with accuracy instead of error, because I don't know, it's more positive. It sounds better, like having a high accuracy sounds better than having a low error for some reason. I don't know. I like accuracy. It's maybe also because in the context of scikit-learn, everything is in accuracy, and I really like scikit-learn. It's if for those who haven't taken 451, it's a package for traditional machine learning, which has a very nice API. Anyways, so here I have a modified version of my train model function that we used in previous lectures. I will show you the relevant parts in the next slide. And I'm applying this reduce LR on plateau method or scheduler to the validation set accuracy. And essentially I'm saying I want to maximize the validation set accuracy. So every time it plateaus, I want to divide the learning rate by 10. So I'm saying max, because for accuracy, the higher the better. If I use the mini batch loss, I would put min here, right? So essentially, I tried it with many different things, the training set loss, the training set accuracy, the validation set accuracy, the validation set loss. And from all my experience, I find that using it with a validation accuracy happens, for me at least, to work best. All right, so and here are the relevant parts from this train model function. So here I zoomed in. Again, you can find it next to this notebook in the GitHub repository. I will include the link at the bottom. And yeah, essentially we have the loop over the epochs, then the loop over the mini batches. Here I just left out all the code because it would be too long otherwise. And then I'm just saying if we use a scheduler, so this is by default none, but we can, of course, like I showed on the previous slide, provide here the scheduler. So if we have a scheduler and it's set to validation accuracy, it will essentially just do this step based on the validation accuracy which we collect during training. So I have a validation accuracy I keep track of during training. I do this for logging purposes, so I can do a plot later on. And so here I do it on the latest validation set accuracy. If it hasn't improved substantially compared to the previous iteration, so I think it's for over 3 iterations, then it will divide the learning rate by a factor of 10. But you can also set a number to include, like, how often does it have to stagnate before you divide by 10. So there are a lot of options that you may also want to choose. But I found just this works well for me. Yeah, related to learning rate schedulers and optimizers, I also wanted to say something about saving models in PyTorch. We haven't talked about saving models in PyTorch yet, but yeah, it's kind of an important topic, right? So if you train a model, let's say for a certain number of iterations, and you want to use it another day for making predictions, it's of course important to save that model so you don't have to retrain it from scratch every time, right? But also sometimes you just want to train it longer. Let's say you train it for 100 epochs and you find, the loss has not quite converged yet, let me train it longer. So instead of just rerunning the training from scratch, you can, in that case, then just, let's say, load your model from, let's say, a previous round and then continue running it. So saving a model in PyTorch is actually quite simple. So there are two ways of doing it, but I will only show you the recommended way of doing it. So the recommended way is using Torch save on the model state dictionary. So the model state dictionary contains all the model settings and also all the model parameters. However, then also if you use an optimizer that has a state, for example, if you use SGD and change the learning rate would be a state essentially. So you can also save that. So here you can do optimizer.statedict and then it will also save that. It will all be saved as, I think they are actually pickle files, but I'm actually not sure. Well, I think they could be YAML files. I honestly forgot. I just call them .pt files, PyTorch files. And yeah, these contain the settings for your model essentially. And then if you want to load your model, you can use, so you have to do it in two steps. You have to first initialize your model, because here really you're only saving the parameters of the model, like the weights and everything. And here you can, for instance, initialize your model. It has to be the same model that you saved. And then what you do is you have like this load state dict. So it's easy to remember because this is called state dict here, and this is essentially just load state dict. And then, but you have to do an inner torch load here, which is loading this PyTorch file. So if you do that, it will load the model and it will essentially load the weights. So in this state dict are the weights, it will load the weights into that model here. And that's all there is to it, essentially. If you have an optimizer, though, that you saved and you want to reuse, you do the same thing here for the optimizer. For instance, you just initialize a blank optimizer, let's say SGD optimizer with the model parameters, and then you load the state dict. So if you had used a learning rate scheduler that changed the learning rate, it will then update the learning rate, so you don't have to remember or check manually. And then yeah, also for the scheduler, if you use the exponential scheduler, it will of course change over time, right? So in that way, you can also then load the scheduler with its parameters. All right, so and that is essentially how you save and load models in PyTorch.